Yeah.
Sorry, can I ask you a question? Well, first of all, I'd like to applaud your acumen and perseverance and everything. But if you're developing kind of a roadmap of where your idea might go, I'm just wondering, would it be possible for the technology?
Would it be possible for companies like Canon and Oral-B for the toothbrushes to have part of the handling element made of your stuff so that when the first owner gets hold of it, they put the imprint of their own style or handprint on the thing so it's totally personalised?
Yeah, it's possible. And we've done bits of research with two companies on that, actually. And it is possible, but there's a good bit of development in the packaging solution for that. Because obviously it's activated by moisture in the air, and technically it should be possible, yeah.
The more I think about another set of elf clubs made with Sugru grips.
Yeah, I think it's possible, and I think that's what's exciting, actually, when I'm talking about change and adaptability, that I think there's more and more technology, like Sugru is just one thing that's enabling mass personalization. You know, there's rapid manufacturing now where you can have your file, you know, you can design up your chair and have it manufactured locally, like Pinoco.com is an interesting website to look at for that. And, you know, even 3D printing, just like the basics of 3D printing, like it's going to be that the future is personalized, isn't it? So, yeah.
Hi Jane, I just want to say well done as well, and I've used it myself. I think every home should have some. I was just thinking about your glue people in Germany, and they seem to me like Decca Records, who turned down the Beatles. Have you been in touch with them since? Have they said sorry, come back to us?
No. I think everything's very quiet, actually. I don't get back in touch with people. I have had messages from, actually, the people in Blue Tech are very good friends, because they're actually based here. They do send me messages every now and again when they see something and say, well done, and whatever. But, you know, in the end, I think we kind of realise we're on a different track, you know, and they're all about huge volumes and distribution network, really, whereas I think we're more on the creative side for now anyway, yeah.
Do I understand you correctly that all of your sales are over the web? You're not in shops. Do you think you'll keep it that way?
We're starting to sell in shops, and the Science Gallery here are selling Sugru since about a month ago, and the Design Museum in London, and then we're starting to sell in smaller shops, so there's some like craft stores and bike shops and things like that. So, and possibly some of the and some hardware stores. I'm a little bit wary of the kind of bigger things because we need to grow bit by bit. But we definitely do intend on growing. But I think the possibilities for independent retail are very exciting, because with Sugru, it's quite important that the person that sells it, knows what it does and everything. So we're very excited to work with independent retailers. When you take it, it comes in little foil packs, and so the question was, how long do you have to mould it, and how long does it take to set? So once you take it out of the pack, you've got about half an hour to an hour to mould it into your shape, and then you need to leave it overnight, depending on how thick it is. If it's a very thin piece, that could cure, you know, within a few hours. But if it's a thicker piece, like on my phone, I would do that like last thing at night, and it would be fine in the morning.
Hi there. How are you doing over here?
Yeah.
I'm just wondering, does the product itself, can it stick to smooth surfaces together, or does it need to grip around something? Like, has it got an adhesive quality as well as a setting quality?
Yeah, so that was probably the hardest thing to do, was to give it the adhesive properties and to make it stick to lots of different things, you know, because it's one chemistry to stick something to wood, and it's another chemistry to stick something to plastic, so that was very tricky to get something to be really versatile. It sticks very well to natural materials like glass, ceramics, metals, things like that. Some plastics are harder. It's good to like plastics like laptops and plugs and adapters, things like that. But like soft plastic like water bottles or plastic bags, that kind of thing, it'll never stick to that. But yeah, it's nothing to do with how smooth the surface is. It's the surface chemistry of the material, really.
And just a little follow-on question. The guy who went to the North Pole, obviously it's down minus 30, minus 40 degrees. How did he get on? Does it crack?
Yeah.
At a point?
That's a really great thing about silicones, and it's why we chose to work in silicones is because they have this amazing temperature properties. So you can put that in the dishwasher, and like that's one of the harshest conditions there is. And it's fine up to 180 degrees and down to about minus 50.
And then eventually it would crack, though, would it?
No, it'll never crack. What will happen is, if you put that in, it will never crack because it's rubbery, so it'll never crack. But what will happen is, if you put it in, in the oven, for example, what would happen is it would never melt, but it would just lose its strength, and you'd be able to kind of tear it apart, kind of thing. Yeah. So they come in, we pack them into individual bits, and then they come in multiples. So our small pack has 6 pieces, and that's £6, so it's €8. I'm working in pounds. And the bigger pack has 12, and that's €14, I think. Here.
I was just wondering about your advertising strategy. Do you actually just base it on TV or website or shops or like...
We haven't actually done any advertising. It's everything has been by word of mouth until now, and we don't really plan on doing advertising really, unless we did some maybe some. We've done bits of competitions and things. So like for example, there's an amazing website. I don't know if people. Probably know it, instructables.com. That's like it's a big kind of how-to DIY site, and we sponsored a competition on there, which that was amazing to see, because it's really just about introducing Sugru to a community of people who are going to find it useful, and yeah, they did great stuff. Yeah.
Sorry, I'm just wondering what's the shelf life of the unopened package?
So that's one of the things that we're really working on improving, actually, because we're not happy with what we have at the moment, but we've had to go with it. So it's 8 months from our manufacture date, and then we guarantee 6 months to the customer from the day they buy it. So you need to not buy more than you're going to use in 6 months, and we encourage people to just buy what they'll use.
Is it okay with water, the Sugru?
Yeah, so it's great with water once it's cured, but before it's cured, like while you're working with it, the only reason you would have water is if you didn't want it to stick to something. So for example, if you wanted to make a part that was going to mold on here but that you wanted to be able to take it off, you could wet the bit of the foam and then it wouldn't stick. But as far as it goes afterwards, once it's cured, like once it's like that and rubbery, it's fine. And we've had people use it in canoeing and windsurfing and stuff, so it's even fine in the sea.
Hi, Jane, well done. I'd only heard about your, just up here at the back.
Oh yeah.
I just heard about your product this week on the radio, on one of the radio stations. And I looked at your website yesterday. I don't think it'll get mixed up with any glue companies anytime soon.
Okay.
My question is just, back to kind of raw materials, how environmentally friendly is your new production and the materials you use to put into the product?
Yeah, that's a tricky one, because obviously you're making stuff, and it's not paper, even though paper is questionable, and it's silicone, so it's not an oil-based plastic, it's a silicone, which supposedly more environmentally friendly, but to be honest, I'm slightly uncomfortable with saying it's environmentally friendly because of exactly that reason. It's not readily recyclable because the infrastructure isn't there. Silicone is very recyclable, and They grind it up and recycle it into playgrounds and things like that. But they won't take it in your domestic in your domestic bin. So it's a little bit of a tricky one. And we hope that using a little bit of Sugru helps something bigger last for that much longer, that it makes that difference. And also, we hope that beyond just using the Sugru to keep things going, that we're promoting a mindset and, you know, a way of looking at things that means that you do try to reduce waste beyond even what is, you know, more of a lifestyle, I suppose.
It and it dries up, would you be able to remove it easily, and would you be able to reuse it, or would it be?
Yeah, so you once you have it on there, like for example how I have it on my iPhone, I could cut that off with a sharp knife if I wanted to, for example, sell my phone, and what would happen is there'd be a little bit of residue, and then I could wipe that off with a tissue and there would be no trace of it. And in fact, I've changed colours a few times and things. And that's fine, but reusing it afterwards, you can't, it won't become malleable again. Once it's cross-linked and set, it's set. But what you can do is, if you were making a bigger Sugru thing, you could use it almost like a filler to fill up a bit or something like that, but that's a bit more advanced, so I'd probably say no.
Thank you.
How did you get the name?
The name, that's a very, very good question, actually. The name is inspired by the Irish word Sugra for play. And it was very hard to come up with a name, and it's something that we struggled with for ages. And it came to me one day when I was cycling on my bike, and the word kind of just came in my head. I was like, that is cool. What if we just took off the DH and made the U? That would look nice. So we had to have a word that would basically be short enough that, you know, it wouldn't be complicated. So one or two syllables is good. And then it had to look nice on paper. So it had it couldn't have a big G coming off the side or a big H or something. You know, it had to look nice and round on the written word. And then the word had to be easy to say in different languages, because we wanted to sell it all over the place. You know, it had to be easy for French people to say, and it had to be easy for, people in Japan to say. And so Sugru worked like that. And then what we had to do to make sure that we could use the name is we had to search, what could we get the .com domain name? And we were able to get Sugru.com. We had to pay a bit for it. We had to pay £500, I think, or something to get it. But we were able to get it. And then you had to make sure in the trademark register that nobody else was selling a product called Sugru. And then you had to file a registration so that you could own that name and someone else isn't going to sell something under Sugru. So, yeah, good question. And actually, by the way, and Kevin from the Irish Times pointed out to me that Lego is the Danish word for play, which I didn't know before.
And are you selling it in big stores or newsagents?
Not newsagents yet. Hopefully someday. But we're selling it mainly in small places. So the Science Gallery shop here is selling it. And we're talking to a few other retailers in Ireland as well, some hardware stores and things as well. And hopefully it'll be in a good few shops in Ireland over the next year, so watch out for it. Yeah.
Sorry, is there one time
putting
the audience?
Funny you should say that, because I grew up watching The Late Late Show as well. And there's not a full pack for everyone, but there's a sachet for everyone to take home. Yeah.